I am back, and you are comfortably zoned with me, the Zigzag Man, in, well, actually, the new studios, not the old 420 studios. We are in the new 420 studio on Lincoln Avenue in Alameda. And happy to be here, give you a little better sound this way. And just to test that out, I want to give you some music, which I haven't been able to give you in a little bit, before introducing my terrific guest from Connecticut. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly, because, you know, I don't want to get in bad stead with the people in Connecticut. So I don't think I will when I play a little music and enjoy this this Wilbury song that kind of puts my existence into perspective. Hey, you ain't going to be thinking of me and wondering about me. I know you won't, but you will be wondering about where Tony D'Angelo is and how he's doing. Tony, Connecticut, how are you?
I am doing fine, my friend. Thank you for having me on.
Oh, man, you're a pleasure to have on. You've been on two or three times before. You and I have always talked baseball. You were a Dodger fan growing up, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, and switched to the Mets at a very early age when they started to play in the Polo Grounds.
Were they playing in the Polo Grounds, or were they just imitating people that played at the Polo Grounds?
Well, you know, it's interesting. You look at the 1962 year, they had actually lost a whole lot of games by one run, you know, so it was – it was the way they were losing games that made them the subject of, futility. And Bill Gallo, God bless him, in the Daily News would draw the caricatures of Basement Bertha and June Swoon and everybody.
Right.
And Casey Stengel had his choice of which one he wanted to date. It was a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah. And there was, for me, I was a little older than you are. I kind of like Casey and the Rheingold girls in the subway. They had the, if you're not from New York, who's not from New York? Who didn't grow up back there? But I'm sure, you know, some of us didn't. Some of y'all didn't.
So well, I'll explain. Miss Rheingold very well with Stengel.
Miss Rheingold, they used to have posters in the subway advertising.
You voted for.
Right, and they were all cute as hell, and we were all, 15, 16 years old, and it'd be cool that they once in a while the Rheingold poster would show Casey with one of the candidates or the actual Miss Rheingold, and it was all in good fun, but losing wasn't fun, and I just want to elaborate why they were losing those one-run games. Is their defense, their hitting wasn't bad. Their pitching wasn't bad. Their defense was atrocious, unbelievably so. Guys that were playing under their heads, Felix Mantilla, who was a tremendous utility guy with Milwaukee for a long time, and was expected to be solid. Rod Kneale was not expected to be as bad as he was. Chacon was horrible. They had Thomas at third base for a lot of the time, and they made a horrible mistake of trading Hobie Landreth sometime in May for Marvelous Marv Thornberry.
That's right.
Hobie Landreth was the first Met drafted. Casey said of Hobie, well, of the team, he says, well, if you don't have a catcher, you're going to have a lot of pass balls.
So, he's also dead at the present time. This is what I was telling.
Right. And I think Hobie is still with us. I hope so, because.
No, I meant Casey. Yeah, I hope Hobie.
Oh, no. Yeah, yeah. Oh, yes, Casey, at the present time, right. Casey was an incredible character. We could do 12 shows on Casey Stengel every day and not cover it at all. What's your favorite Casey Stengel story? I'll tell you mine.
My favorite Casey Stengel story. I think it was when Mickey and Billy and I believe it was Whitey, they were playing an exhibition game, and they were in Cincinnati, and they were out the night before, and they were going to go to Pittsburgh. And what happened, as well as I understand it, is they missed the bus. So they took a cab to the airport, and it was snowing, and the planes weren't flying. So they got the cab driver to drive them in the snow at about a $400 fare, which was used back then, all the way to Pittsburgh. And then when they got to the park, they tried to just mix in with everybody and, not let Casey know that they had missed the flight. And what happened was, is Ford went down with the pitchers. Billy Martin ran out of the clubhouse. And Casey went to Mickey Mantle and grabbed him and sat him down in the dugout and says, you're going to play every one of these 9 innings. and Mickey, I think, finally hit a home run in like the 7th inning, and Casey took him out. You know, that's that would be my favorite Casey Stengel story. That and maybe falling asleep on the bench.
Right. That, and he was lambasted in those early days by a tough New York press and a
right.
tough New York media. They had Howard Cosell doing the pre- and post-game shows.
With Ralph Branca.
Or
from
big
Howard
number
Cosell's
thir- town. Howard would go big number 13, Ralph
exactly.
Branca, right? Good days, but they did, and Jackie Robinson would either guest or he might have had a show for a while.
He didn't live too far from there.
Yeah,
they all live, you know, relatively close together.
Right, and it was just the days when the media was very tough on players. I'm out of touch. I live in California. Is the media still as tough on New York players as it was back in the 50s and 60s when I was growing up?
I think it's different since the clubs now have direct ownership in the television production, and that's become so big. I mean, they'll more or less state the facts, but yet very rarely do you see the scathing article about someone's performance like you used to. That seems to be, I'm not saying it's a thing of the past, but it's not as acutely, shall we say, derisive as it was, you know, in years gone by.
Okay. Who is your favorite media? Who did you go to your morning paper to, or even your afternoon paper to, your favorite columnist when you were growing up?
Oh, unquestionably Dick Young.
Me too. Me,
unquestionably.
The most not because you liked him, not because you liked the Dodgers who he fit, or in my case, not because you liked the Dodgers. I was a Giant fan. But he was the most interesting. He just had it out there. And then he changed. Then he went so pro-ownership that he was basically responsible for putting Seaver in a bad enough light that the public was able to fathom the idea of getting rid of him, and that was M. Donald McDuck.
Right. Or M. Donald Boob or whatever you wanted to call him.
Right. Wow. Those shocking days when he was traded and Kingman was traded. It was just, it was not good. Not good. But, yes, Dick Young in his day really had it going. And then there was Leonard Coppett, who I got to meet and interview later on in his life. And
I do like Phil Pepe. I've spoken to him on several occasions, and Phil is still Phil. You know, he still tells you exactly what he's thinking and looks
right.
Great and sounds great and writes a book a year.
Yeah. And speaking of media people, I'm going to segue into why I talked to you earlier in the week and wanted you on specifically this week is to talk about Frank Gifford, the late Frank Gifford now, who
right.
passed earlier on. He was an icon in New York. He was an absolute New York football giant hero, and you knew of those days, you were a little young yourself, but you grew up in Connecticut, and the pride of Connecticut was Mr. Andy.
Yeah, Andy Mr. Robustelli, and he was from Stamford. He was a son of the West Side, a pillar in the community, a great banquet speaker. I mean, we would go to league banquets, and this is amazing, Zig, and we would have as speakers Andy Robustelli and Mel Allen. And Mel always
oh, wow.
had that line about, you know, and I can't do Mel like Mel, but, you know, people wondering how I got to broadcast the Yankees. You know, I didn't start out as a broadcaster. I actually started out in the practice of law. You know, I passed the bar in Georgia, and I haven't passed one since. And from there, the room would break up, and Mel would tell you stories about Casey and Mickey and Whitey, and you would just sit there as a kid, and your eyes would be as big as saucers.
Yeah, well, let me digress for just one second and tell you my favorite Casey story. And it's almost indirect. It's we were talking about Thornberry before and how horrible he was. As an example, in a doubleheader in June in 1962 that I attended alone, I couldn't find anybody in the schoolyard that wanted to go to the ball game. And
want to go to the Met game? No, get away from me.
right. And maybe the Yankees were playing one of those rare times when they were both in town. Or maybe by June, everybody was just tired of it. But I went to a doubleheader. One of the games, Lou Brock hit a home run into the center field bleachers, one of maybe eight guys that
yeah.
did it in history. And this is a little skinny Lou Brock with the Cubs. And the Mets, and the other game, Thornberry hits what appears to be a triple. Casey comes out of the dugout, and he's going to argue the fact that one of the umpires said he missed first base. And Casey, well, he's going to argue. And Lavagetto greets him, and he says, wait a minute, Casey, he missed second base too. So we're dead on this. We're dead on this one. Forget about it. He turns around and walks back in the dugout. That's how bad. Thornberry, and he was a Yankee prospect coming up, a big
yeah.
coming up, big hitter at Denver.
Like your commercials, you know, he was so funny.
Oh, absolutely.
He was just playing himself.
Yeah. They had a lot of great moments in ex-athletes, former athletes coming on. And Thornberry was among the best. Billy Martin and Steinbrenner coming up against each other in those commercials was priceless.
For certain.
Yeah, you're fired again. Yeah.
Well, you know, and this is, how could I put it? I guess these are the kinds of stories that you say are apocryphal, if that's really, you know, the most apt term to describe them. I had a college classmate, and this was in 1976 when the Yankees were back in the World Series playing the Reds, and they were getting the tar kicked out of them. It was brutal. And I believe it was game three at Yankee Stadium. We had come into class, and one of my classmates was remarking to a group of, you know, other people in the back, and he said, you know, last night his uncle, this particular classmate's uncle, owned a gas station somewhere off of Route 17 in Hasbrook Heights, New Jersey. Martin used to stay in the Sheraton Hotel, which is like in the back of Route 17 on the way to the bridge. He didn't have a home, which putting Billy anywhere near bars and hotels and things was like adding gasoline to a fire. So as the story was told, I cannot prove it, I cannot disprove it, but it sounds, you know, reasonable enough to be true. The fellow's uncle's working that night. I guess he had the TV with the antennas. He's following the game. And in out of nowhere comes speeding into the gas station this baby blue Mark IV Continental. And it's the tires screech. It clobbers a gas pump. Gas is spurting out all over the place. Popping out of the car is Billy Martin. Billy's scratching his head, and of course Billy's drunk, and he's like marveling at what he did. However, it gets better. He's with Mickey Mantle, who's sitting in the front seat laughing his head off. And Billy's like, you know, what'd I do? And he looks at the pump, he looks at the fella, and he takes $200 bills out of his pocket, gives him, I'm sorry, kid, I'm very sorry about that, gets back in the car, and they go screeching down Route 17. I mean, this is Billy's post-game reaction. You get drunk, and you get Mantle, and you drive around, and, you know, you try not to kill people. But
they were incredible alcoholics, and Billy imploded and lost his job. He was manager of the A's out here. And he was doing very well, as he did in most every stop. He just had demons and could not control them. And he, I have anecdotes about my friend of mine had a pizza shop in the East Bay, which is east of the stadium. And Billy was living out that way in Contra Costa and in San Ramon, and my friend's pizza store was there. And after the game, Billy would come knocking on the door. The store would be closed, and Billy would be drunk as a mother and just screaming at Rocky to let me in, and all that. And Rocky just would turn off the light, go in the back of the store, and go to sleep. He wasn't going to have this guy come in. Who the hell is Billy Martin outside of baseball? You know, what gives some of these people the entitlement to drive like that? First of all these things. I mean, back in those days, fine, but this time it was the 80s when he's doing this.
Right.
You know, Campanella had already
drunk driving.
Campanella?
You know, and that's what's so sad.
Yeah, with Campy, you mean? Is that what you're saying?
Well, no, Billy Martin.
Oh, no, when Billy Martin died.
Absolutely,
and that was so sad, and allegedly Roy Campanella, and this is back in 1957, the winter of 1957, when there were no seat belts, Campy owned a liquor store in Harlem.
Yes, he did.
And he'd been known to take a sip or two after closing, and yes, he did. And there were no seatbelts, and he slid off an icy road going out to Long Island where he lived, or maybe even Connecticut, somewhere in the suburbs.
I think he did live on the north shore of Long Island.
Ah, okay. Good knowledge. That's you're incredible. Great memory. But it should – I mean, our heroes aren't really – I guess what we're saying, they have clay feet, and there's a lot of – a lot of folks struggle, and the pressure of playing the game brings on a lot of abuse of drugs and alcohol. And there you go. That's too bad. So let's get to Frank Gifford, an icon And he played on that 1956 team with Robustelli against the Baltimore Colts that really changed pro football. This was the TV game that was went into overtime. Alan Ameche carries the ball in. Patton just standing there. They had a hole open about you could drive a truck through it. And they beat a great New York team. They were a great Baltimore team, Johnny Unitas and the boys. So what are your memories of that? What are your memories of GIF?
Well, you know, when you think of GIF, if you were a kid of my age in the greater New York metropolitan area, Gifford was a constant, Zig, through so many things in your life. I mean, probably the first year I bought football sports cards, you know, that back then they were put out by the Philadelphia Gum Company. And I remember to this day pulling out a very beautiful card, a color picture of Frank Gifford in a three-point stance with his blue home New York Giants jersey. And, you know, not a hair out of place, Frank Gifford. I think back then he was called a flanker back, today's, you know, wide receiver. He was kind of a mixed-use player. After which he retired that year. I don't have a lot of memories of him playing. I do remember watching him. But he more or less from that point jumped onto local television, CBS, for the most part, doing sports. And working sports on the news, going out to do interviews and things, and he really was almost like a Walter Cronkite of sports. He was a trusted, known presence, and from what I understand, he followed broadcasting because of Kyle Rote, who started before him, and Pat Summerall, who started before him, and Tom Brookshire. And he more or less kind of fit that same mold, that trusted ex-player. But to his credit, he was an extremely hard worker, and he worked and he worked, and he got better, and he made mistakes, and he'd work to correct them, and he was very serious. What he did, you know, to be a great football player, he actually, you know, had that same work ethic when it came to broadcasting. And for years and years, he was the nightly sports anchor on the Eyewitness News and Channel 7 in New York when he had crossed over into ABC, and that eventually brought him into Monday Night Football. But again, a guy very serious about his craft, not a perfect man, as we've discussed, but certainly a serious one who tried his best and did his best and had a remarkable career in both broadcasting and in sports. So he was really a fixture, you know, for all of us. And, I mean, you just knew he would be there. And, we can speak as adults on your show. I've said to anybody who will listen that if he did not have that, shall we call it an indiscretion in the late 1990s, with a woman who was not his wife. I mean, I'm not talking out of school. You know, you can look this up, or anybody can. He probably would have been an emeritus presence on Monday Night Football, maybe right up until now. You know, he was just, you know, he was really sort of America's voice of football. And not only that, without Frank Gifford, if you really stop and think about it, going back to 1970, he, Dandy Howard, and taking football out of that Sunday kind of this is a man's sport sort of bubble, they really took football and they mainstreamed it and marketed it into something that could be played against a television show that became entertainment and sport that became interesting to women and men. You know, very good-looking man that he was, he had a lot to do with that. And, you know, and this is a guy, the NFL today, which is bigger than life, a large part of that's attributable to Frank Gifford. So that's what I think about Frank Gifford.
I agree with you totally, and I just want to elaborate on one thing you said. I think if he hadn't had the discretion, if he just had the discretion, as it were, nobody would give a rat's ass.
Mm-hmm.
What it was that he was hypocritical, and it was his high-on-the-horse hypocrisy Christian bullshit that he preached going in, wrote books about it, and the life he led with Kathy Lee and all that stuff. And if it were just some guy doing it, but he's criticizing people. Remember, he criticized, they shared a locker, did Mickey Mantle and him.
Yes, that's correct.
And he was very hard on Mantle when Mantle was just an open player, whereas as Gifford wasn't an open player, but he was kind enough to really come down on Mantle unnecessarily. And I'm not just taking that from what, I mean, this was in Gene Levy's book
mm-hmm.
on Mantle. And remember, this is one of my boyhood heroes. And I'll tell you an anecdotal story about that in a second. So he was tremendous. Yes, flanker, all purpose. He was at
yeah.
one time the backup quarterback, more in an emergency, but he played a little quarterback for them. And he was terrific, as was Kyle Rote, who you mentioned before. It was the hypocrisy of it that got me, and I think that's what it was. Hey, you mess around, who does it? I mean, I don't particularly. Why? Because I'm tired from the weekend when I did. hey, I'm human. I'm only human, but I'm not subhuman. So there you go. The bar is set low on humanity, and it's those with the high horse that and I don't think he copped to it right away, and they had tapes, and it just put him in a bad light, and I think drinking had a lot to do with it. And but he was all of those things, and more. He was just a human being like all of us, good, bad, and indifferent. We're all gray. None of us are perfect.
Well, you know, and the thing, like, we had a sports show on Monday night, and Bob Lazari and I were talking about him. We were, you know, giving
any
tribute to him.
What's the name of that show again? I know
it's Monday Night Sports Talk.
And that's an offshoot of your...
No, that runs separately. That's something I do with Bob Lazari on Monday nights out of a little cable station here in North Windham, Connecticut.
Okay. Do you have a website for this, or how can people...
Sure, www.mondaynightsports.net.
Beautiful. Repeat it one more time. The one listener that I have is so freaking slow, I got to speed his ass up.
Well, there's actually two places you could see videos. www.mondaynightsports.net. Or you could go to YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. And when you get to YouTube, you can type in just one word, Monday Night Sports 14. And you'll see our channel and a lot of our past interviews. And we've had some, we've been blessed to have some really great people.
What's
but,
the 14 significant of? I'll bet it has something to do with somebody's number. Was it Koozie?
Oh, 14?
Yeah.
No, when we started, we were on channel 14. So
oh, okay.
No real science other than that.
Okay. Well, there's no real science going on in my head anyway.
anyway, we were talking about Frank Gifford, and I had said to Bob, I said, you realize something? For all the things they've credited him with doing, for years and years and years and years, he did the anchor desk at Wide World of Sports, ABC, and that was really a tough thing to do because you had four different major events or five and four different major correspondents, and they'd be going back and forth. I mean, that was the whole Rune Arledge thing. You keep a lot of things moving in the same direction. You know, you could either call it brilliant or ADD. It was both. And Frank was just, and he'd do interviews and live interviews and promos as these events were happening. And I would sit, you know, when I had the time to actually sit and watch television on a Saturday afternoon, it hasn't happened in about 35 years, I would sit just transfixed at how well he did this and how well he, you know, moderated it and kept it incredibly interesting.
That's,
you know, and that he did a really great job with that.
You know, there was a guy here in San Francisco that did local sports anchor for the local ABC station, and I think he might have been Channel 5, which was CBS. His name was Wayne Walker, and he was so underrated for much the same kind of steadiness. He did it for a long time, and he wasn't like number one in the market or anything, but he really was good, and he was a former player. And in those days, most former players didn't really do well, and a lot of them got jobs because of their – Koufax was one, didn't do very well at all in front of a microphone. Some people like it. Some people are comfortable. Some people don't do well and get to keep their jobs for years based on a name that they might have had in 1971.
Oh, sure.
So it's a crazy industry, and but Gifford was he certainly was someone that made a big dent in American culture for, you know, both playing and
many ways.
And so thank you for coming on and sharing this. This is my show. The older I get, the more my show becomes a necrology. I mean, come on, talk about people. I mean, the average age of my listener is now deceased. So I got some numbers in, and I'm talking to a lot of dead people, as Casey would say.
Well, remember one thing. These dead people are allowed to vote in Chicago, Detroit, and Bridgeport, Connecticut.
Oh, and in San Francisco, I'm sure, because today I'll just off the top of my head, we got a sheriff that had a case going where, never mind. I don't even want to get into Sheriff Ross, because it's a local thing, and how this guy got to be sheriff and how he keeps his job is amazing. That's San Francisco, ladies and gentlemen, for another show. Don't want to ruin my mood today because, you know, things are so messed up. And when I get into stuff that's serious, I try to avoid it because it
has a negative
effect. Oh, I know.
Don't remind me of reality. I get you right on, let me tell you.
Right? Can you remember a time when things have been this crazy on so many different levels in this country?
Yeah.
We got a clown car of Republican candidates. It's absolutely unbelievable. And you know what? Trump is doing it on purpose to try to make Hillary look good, if that's even possible. I'm a Bernie guy anyway. But it's craziness. We don't know what to do, and we're doing it at full speed anyway. But this is sports, and it's been fun. We talk sports, and I try not to get the craziness into it, but it's all part of life. You can't get on the internet without going, holy shit, did that really happen, or is this The Onion? You know.
You're right. It's another show for another time.
Another show for another time. If you'd like to talk about what I call the unholy trinity, and I think it's big business, government, and organized religion.
Mm-hmm.
And they, if you have an unholy trinity story that you need to vent, you just let me know. You always have a microphone because you got a good brain, Tony.
Well, thank you, and it's an honor to be here as always.
Thank you again, and please come back. I'm going to end the segment the way I do everyone. I implore you, Tony, and all of my listeners, to keep your dreams wet and your humor dry. keep your children and grandchildren out of military recruiting offices. It will ruin your life, their life, and the life of your family some way or the other. And here's one that's optional, of course, because you're going to do it anyway. Don't let your kids sit on the laps of clerics wearing dresses. Just to be on the safe side. Have your kids frolic with someone else just to be on the safe side. A lot of the stuff, people get bad raps, this, that, and the other thing. But yes, a lot of that seems to be going on, made the papers for a long time. So it's absolutely troubling, and there doesn't appear to be much of an effort to change things. There's a lot of cover-up. There's a lot of words. We have the new pope is absolutely a great man with great words, and I would like to see those words transcend where women get a better chance in the church, and any organized religion, women. That's how you could tell it's all bad and bullshit, because women don't get to pray with men. They don't get to wear the same silly hats. They don't get to take off the same silly hats. All those things, it's just a man's club, and some are little boys' clubs. So, thanks, Tony, man. We'll talk again soon.
Okay, listen, take care. We'll be talking soon.
All right, and to everybody out there, keep on keeping on, and adios, amigos, and amigas.
Thank you, Zig. Good day.
Thanks, Tony.